and our prayers. And may we become a sweet fragrance through our good works and actions. Hear our petitions and grant rest to our departed in your dwelling place of joy. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Praise be to God always. Before the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy.
Listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
The Evangelist Luke writes, afterward Jesus journeyed from one town and village to another, preaching and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom of God. Accompanying him were the 12, and some women who had been cured of evil spirits and infirmities. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out. Joanna, the wife of Herod's steward, Cusa. Susanna, and many others who provided for them out of their resources. When a large crowd gathered, with people from one town after another journeying to see him, he spoke in a parable. A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some seed fell on the path and was trampled, and the birds of the sky ate it up. Some seed fell on rocky ground, and when it grew, it withered for lack of moisture. Some seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew with it and choked it. And some seed fell on good soil, and when it grew, it produced fruit 100-fold. After saying this, he called out, whoever has ears to hear, let him hear. Then his disciples asked him what the meaning of this parable might be. He answered, knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of God has been granted to you. But to the rest, they are made known through parables, so that they may look but not see, and hear but not understand. This is the meaning of the parable. The seed is the word of God, and those on the path are the ones who have heard, but the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, that they may not believe and be saved. Those on rocky ground are the ones who, when they hear, receive the word with joy, but these have no root. They believe only for a time, and then fall away in time of temptation. As for the seed that fell among thorns, they are those who have heard, but as they go along, they are choked by the anxieties and riches and the pleasures of life, and they fail to produce mature fruit. But as for the seed that fell on rich soil, these are those who, when they have heard the word, embrace it with a generous and good heart, and they bear fruit through perseverance. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ.
Last week in the healing of the Canaanite woman's daughter from demonic possession, We talked about the question of how God works, and that grace which is marked with the sign of the cross, simultaneously with its mark of the resurrection and life. That's the question from God's initiative. For us now, this week becomes, what is the receiving end of this grace? And so our Lord gives us this parable of the sowing of the seed. When we talk about the question of salvation, this health, this well-being, this integration, this shalom, this shlomo, we're talking about the fact that before the day of the resurrection, we are healed, but we are not cured. We are healed in the sense that the source of the wound is removed. So you think of the question of maybe of scarring over. But a scar is not a full cure. It indicates the previous wound. What healing does is remove from us the wound, the origin of its source. And of course, in the work of redemption, what the Messiah comes to remove is original sin. That is his first purpose, is to restore the original integrity fundamentally of the primitive creation, as God meant things to be. But that does not bring us a full cure. We still go through life suffering and ultimately dying. Because our Lord has transformed death into life, but that restoration will only take place on the last day. And so we can say that when grace comes to us, this mark of the cross and this mark of the resurrection, it removes the source of the wound from us. But at the same time, we await for the full restoration, the full cure, which will be in the resurrection. But all the same, healing begins now by the presence of grace within us. That's why the context of today's gospel, this parable, which our Lord explains, so that's not too complicated, is in the context that immediately before this teaching, we have the famous episode, which certainly you all know, of the woman, the sinful woman, who's known publicly as a sinner, who comes bursting into the dinner, falls at the feet of our Lord, and anoints his feet. In the Western tradition, we identify her with Mary Magdalene. But in the East, they've never identified her as Mary Magdalene. They see her as a different woman. Be that as it may, the story is very clear, that her sins are forgiven her because she has come to love much. So that's what is the beginning context to this episode then which follows with our Lord today. And then following this, our Lord gives another parable, which St. Matthew puts in the Sermon on the Mount. That you do not light a lamp to put it under a bushel. That illumination, that light, is not set up on a stand so that you then take that lamp and hide it. So we have the aspect of illumination, of grace that comes to us, and grace that has to shine forth, not be hidden. And before that, the healing of this woman. That's why in the context, St. Luke then talks about these women. This entourage of these good and these wonderful and these generous women who follow our Lord. And it says that many of them are following because for them it's a reciprocation. They are grateful for being healed. They are grateful for having been freed from demons, as in the case of Mary Magdalene. And she's named. And of course, two other women are also named. We don't know exactly why, what healing they may have received, but some of these women have connections. We're told that one of them is the wife of the chief steward of King Herod. So this is not just simply a group of unknown people. The people who are beginning to follow our Lord, some of them are quite significant. But we're told that what is happening is that these people come, and that from their own resources, they are supporting our Lord and the 12 apostles. For 2,000 years now, these good and wonderful, generous women have always followed our Lord. It doesn't matter what parish you go to, what you're at, you're always going to find these good and generous women who surround our Lord to this day. But one of the things that I wanted to point out is precisely this detail. Our Lord is traveling around with a whole group, not only of the apostles, but with women. Now, we know from watching CNN and the talk and the arguments that go on with Saudi Arabia, whether women should drive, wear their veils, not wear veils, all these different aspects, and the complete segregation of men and women in all public life is exactly the world that our Lord lived in. It's exactly the same thing. But our Lord was trundling about from town to town with a whole entourage of women with him that were not his relatives would have been quite shocking to the people at the time. But our Lord brushes that aside because it's the individual and the transformation that's great importance. It's why in the Gospel of St. John, our Lord with a woman at the Samaritan woman at the well, it's also the shock. They come back and find him talking to this woman in public that he's not related to. So it's just one of those details to see the context in which what our Lord is talking about, how grace, when it comes into the world, can have rather dramatic effects if the receiving end of it is properly disposed. This is the key to this parable. In this context, and I make a reference to it by putting a footnote in the bulletin this week, we have in our Syriac translation part of the spirituality in the translation in the Syriac that the fathers make reference to, that St. Ephrem will make reference to, and that's the Lebo Shafio. What is translated here as being good or an honest heart. In the Syriac, Lebo Shafio literally means a luminous heart, clarity. It literally means, and in the spirituality of the Syriac tradition, we have the Shafiuto, which is luminosity. It's the aspect of what is supposed to be what we enter into by grace, but that grace is meant to transform us. And so Lebo Shafio is that what our Lord talks about at the end, those who receive with a good and luminous heart, they go on, this seed produces fruit 100-fold. Now when we speak about heart, for us in the 21st century, we think of an anatomical organ. But in the Semitic tradition, in the meaning of the scriptures, for that reason, heart refers to the whole centrality of a person. It refers to the very inner core of who someone is. It's the reason why we have the Sacred Heart. The Sacred Heart is not referring to an anatomy, even though we may portray it that way in images. It's referring to the person of the Word who is incarnate. And so here our Lord is talking about the Lebo Shafio, the luminous heart of the individual hearing the Word of God, receiving the grace of God. We are meant to become, we can say, translucent conductors, to use a more modern terminology. Translucent, that the shining takes place through us. That's the Shafio. The heart is our being and a disposition, but also a conductor of this light towards others. That the kingdom of God is not just something which is given to us, it is also something which we ourselves conduct and by that help create and expand. That's why the context of this gospel is our Lord teaching about the fact of lighting a lamp and not hiding it, but you place it on the candlestick. So having said all that, the parable is just easy to understand, our Lord explains it. But what the fathers of the church refer to, these three possibilities, or four possibilities that take place, one being, of course, the good ground, the honest and the luminous heart, the Lebo Shafio, that receives this word and is transformed and shines light out as a result, which is its fruitfulness. The other three are what the fathers refer to as the three classic oppositions to God, which are the devil, the flesh, and the world. The devil stand out very clearly. They are beings of light. They are just simply intellects. In our Syriac tradition, we call them watchers. They are always, they never sleep. They are spiritual beings which are simply intelligence. And therefore, by that reason, they are light. In their very natural being. But they have refused the seed. They have refused the word. And therefore their envy and jealousy is that anywhere possible that light is being created and spread by God, they stand in opposition. And that's the first example when our Lord speaks about the sower of the seed. And I suppose I should give another detail. When we talk about sowing a field, I mean, now we think about tractors making nice straight furrows and laying the seed and planting and harvesting. This is not the way it's done in the Middle East, certainly at the time of our Lord. You would break up the soil of your field, and then you would take all of your seed in an apron, and you would walk through the broken soil, throwing the seed this way and that to plant the seed. So there's no John Deere taking place here with really nice straight. So the seed is being scattered. We have to explain it because, of course, everyone listening to our Lord at the time would have understood this. Why is the seed going everywhere? Why is it in the thorns and on the pathway and on the stones? Well, because you're throwing it. And it's inevitable that some of it's going to land on that pathway that runs along. But what is the path? The path is trodden down, stamped upon soil. It's a dirt path, which is hard. This dirt has been broken up, and it is able to receive the seed. The path is not able to receive the seed. It's hard. It's hard of earth. And our Lord uses that as the image for the devil. These are the people who hear the word of God, to whom grace comes, and grace comes to everyone in creation. Everyone is given the ability to enter into the vision of God, but not everyone arrives there. And he gives one of the reasons being is because when this seed comes, it comes to that hardened earth which is not at all receptive to hearing. And so because of that, the birds of the air, the devil comes in the explanation of our Lord, and he removed that seed. These people don't even react to it. To them, the Christian message, the gospel, is completely hidden to them. They have no idea. They can hear the words, but they have no understanding of it at all. Remember our Lord saying at the end, "Let him who has ears to hear, let him hear." So that's the first opposition, is from the demonic. The second and the third are more us. And the second is the flesh. And what the flesh means doesn't mean that we're all fornicating all the time or committing adultery. What the flesh means is that we live at a purely natural level. It's a naturalism. And what our Lord compares it to here is the stone. Why the stones? Because when the seed falls among the stones, it still receives rain. And it may be pulled up among the stones, among the pebbles and gravel. And so these seeds actually do take, they sprout. They do respond to the beginning of the sowing. But when the sun comes out, they dry up, they wither, and they die. And so in our Lord's explanation, what he says of the flesh is that it's arid to live at a naturalistic level. When the grace comes, and our primary concern is nature, the flesh, in the terminology of St. Paul, of just simply the here below horizontal world that we live in, then those individuals may hear the word. They may respond to grace for a moment. And he says they receive it with joy. They like Christmas. They like Easter to some degree because of the peeps, I suppose, and chocolate. But that's as far as they go in hearing the word. But he says that inevitably what happens is the seed dies because there is no moisture. They do not grow, and in the end they die. And so that world of the flesh, that nature, also is in opposition to hearing the word. And lastly, our Lord gives the world. The concerns and the things that we are all submerged in. None of them are bad, but they're not the reason that we are created. We are created for a transcendent goal. Not just simply to be here below to pay off our automobiles. And he says, that's the seed that lands among the thorns. Landing among the thorns, they land in soil. They receive the sun, shadow though, through the thorns, but it still grows. And in growing though, he says, as it comes up, the thorns, of course, the brambles, Itavot madepe dalomo, valot alomo dam chade talio. Weinuk zuvot ayvot aope, ulel baitoch vesvulet payetlo, ot
Thank you.
Please turn to page 754, the Anaphora of the 12 Apostles.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Accept the offering of this bloodless sacrifice and grant us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with pure hearts and divine love, that we may raise glory and thanks to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. To the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O minister of the Holy Spirit.
Let each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
Thank you.
Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and holy is your life-giving Spirit. You are holy and the giver of all that is good. For our salvation, your only begotten Son became flesh of the pure Virgin Mary, and by his divine plan he saved and redeemed us. Kyrie eleison. Vaviano hadokton harsha dilema ben paen, en save lachma vita karishato, o marefu kadesh, vaksoya vetalvita.
Blood of Christ, our God. Amen.
worthy to live by your Spirit in me to cure. We raise glory to you now and forever.
Thank you. pleasing oblation, the law of yourself for us. In our giving sacrifice, the law of yourself to your Father. In our high priest, the law of yourself as the man. Through your mercy, may our prayer rise like incense, which we offer to your Father through you. To you be glory forever.
Compassionate Lord, may we, your lowly servants, be made worthy to pray with purity and holiness. To call upon you, say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Yes, O Lord, lover of all people, deliver us from the evil one and from his deceitful ways. And do not forsake us, lest temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us bow our heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing of the Lord.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share these divine mysteries with purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and made holy. And we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit, let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity. One Holy Father,
one Holy Son,
one Holy Spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your mouth, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood.
May our being indeed for the forgiveness of our sins and for our life. Lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord.
hangs in the vine, it withers and dies. Unless you remain in me, you will not have life.
I am the vine, and you are the branches. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Remain in me, remain in me, and I will remain in you.
Thank you, Lord God and Father, and we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins and the glory of your holy name, and that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation and make us temples of your holy name. For we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.